Good morning, and thank you for taking time to listen to another sermon from First Christian Church here in Florida, Illinois. We're glad to have you this morning as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. If it was not for Him coming out of the grave, we would still be bound to our sins. It reminds me of a story I heard about a little boy and his father who were driving down a country road on a beautiful spring afternoon. Suddenly, out of nowhere, a bumblebee flew in the car window. And since the little boy was deathly allergic to bee stings, he became petrified. His father quickly reached out his hand and grabbed the bee. He squeezed it in his hand and then released it. But as soon as he let it go, the young son became frantic once again as it buzzed by. The father sensed his son's terror, and once again he reached out his hand, but this time he pointed to his hand there. In the middle of his hand was the stinger of the bee. "You see this?" he asked. "You don't have to be afraid anymore. I've taken the sting for you." And for those who choose to follow Christ, do not need to be afraid of death, because Christ has taken the sting out of death and of sin. As Paul writes to the church in Corinth, 1 Corinthians 15, he says, "O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of the sin is the law." So today, as we see our story of Matthew, our series Kingdom Come, God's presence here through the life of Jesus, we see two different groups of people with similar responses and yet total different results. According to the four Gospels, Jesus rose from the dead following his crucifixion. Matthew records for us specifically how the women found the tomb and were instructed by the angels to tell the disciples. The significance of the resurrection of Jesus is so overwhelming. For these women who had first encountered the empty tomb, there could be a lot of disbelief, a lot of questions and wondering. But we see that there's great significance for those who both do not believe and those that do believe. For the resurrection reveals to us of our hope that we have in eternity with Christ. And that was Jesus' life and example as he came to show us not only what we have to look forward to, but rather that we get to spend it with him, that they would soon be our forever if we choose to follow him. And so that is the theme of the book of Matthew: the kingdom of God here with us now and then forever. Today, as we are in Matthew 28, as we end the series of Matthew in this next 2 weeks, we see that he is risen today, but we also see the Great Commission in the coming weeks. But we look at the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And over the last few months, we've gone through this series of the book of Matthew, looking how Jesus was the kingdom of God, that he was sitting here on earth, that we looked and we explored his earthly ministry, from his life, his living, his trials, his teaching, his healing. He showed us what it was like to live and to follow obediently after the Father. But now we've reached the point of the story where now it's not so sweet. We see that he is mocked, that he is tried, that he is beaten, and he is crucified. But even more so, today we celebrate because he is risen. And after Jesus let out his last cry and his last breath on the cross, as Matthew 27 tells us, that he gave up his spirit. What a powerful and important reminder that it is for us that he not only, his life wasn't taken from him, but rather he gave it up for us because he loved us so much. And then after that, that his body was put into the tomb, that it was placed there on a Friday afternoon. Because the evening sunset and the Sabbath was coming, it means that no one could do any physical labor, so therefore no one could come in to tend to the body. The women that we see here coming up couldn't go Friday night. Saturday night probably would have been dark. It probably would have been too late. So therefore, we see that Sunday was the ample opportunity for them to set out and to come and to tend to the body of Jesus. Thankfully, we're able to understand the prophecy, as we are told numerous times throughout Scripture, that he would not only be killed, but that he would also rise on the third day. But while we gather to celebrate this huge moment in the story and the life of Jesus, it's not just good enough to just come. I mean, we can come out of tradition. We can come because this is what we always do. We can come because it's a holiday. It's the time I need to be at church. But we begin to ask the questions of what now? If he did what he said he was going to do, if he came to fulfill the prophecy that he was going to be killed and to be raised on the third day, what does it mean for us now? That's the question. If he did his part, what is our part now in the story? Well, this is where we find these women at the tomb in Matthew 28, verse 1. After the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary and Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. These women loved Jesus more than they loved anyone. They had shared with Jesus and they spent time. And the more that you spend time with Jesus, the more that your love grows. It's a model for all of us to strive to. Well, we can't follow the ways that they follow, but we're able to spend time in His Word. We can pray. We gather in corporate worship. We gather in group study. All these things are acts of worship that we get to know more about our Lord and Savior. So it's a way that we see that the more time you spend, the greater the love grows. Yet, they did this, though, as He shares with them. And He shares with us, Matthew 25, remember the sheep and the goats. He talked about these were the necessities in order to grow. Well, He says, for I was hungry, You gave me something to eat. When I was thirsty, You gave me something to drink. When I was a stranger, You invited me in. When I was needing clothes, You clothed me. When I was sick, You looked after me. Whenever I was in prison, You visited me. See, Mary and Mary, they served Jesus. They provided Him with food and hospitality. And when He was nailed on the cross, they were there by His side. And then when they were there, when He was buried, their devotion was real, that they kept providing. They kept continuing to care for Him. But even as real as their devotion was, they're as deep as the relationship was, their love was pure. It was proven. And now we begin to see that it was justified. But yet, it still doesn't come close to the tomb that day to witness the resurrection. I mean, their purpose was there to anoint the corpse. For as close as they were to Jesus, there was not an act of faith. It was an act of good deed. It needed to be done. Not that these good deeds are bad or that they go unnoticed, but if we only believe in the good deeds, we will be destroyed. Same as if we only believe in the good acts of Jesus, we'll never see the depth of His love. We'll never see that there was thought, there was care, there was pain and suffering behind the act. So as the ladies come to the tomb, unsure how they'll get in or who will be there, they say, it doesn't matter. We're going to go because we want to go and administer this act, love. But upon their arrival, the scene takes a turn. They are instantly terrified. And this is what it's not what they were expecting. In their mind, they already kind of figured this is what was going to go on. But we see in Matthew 28, verse 2, it says, there was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came out and down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and His clothes were like white as snow. The guards were so afraid of Him that they shook and became like dead men. These ladies were stopped dead in their tracks. As an earthquake took place, a reminder that this was not the first earthquake. 3 days prior, they experienced an earthquake as well. We see in Matthew 27:51, at the moment of the curtain, and the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, the earth shook and the rocks split. When Jesus died, the earthquake split the rocks wide open. He opened the graves and the dead people came alive among the saints. When God seeks to do something, when God moves through our world, the world shakes. Exodus 20, when God came down to Mount Sinai to meet Moses, the earth shook at the weight of the majesty in His presence. Jeremiah 10:10, but the Lord is the true God. He is the living God, the eternal King. When He is angry, the earth trembles. The nations cannot endure His wrath. Matthew 28:2, there was a violent earthquake, for the angel of the Lord came down from heaven and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. And after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and they spoke the word of God boldly. When God's presence comes, the world shakes. See, earthquakes prompt fear in those who are there. And it often happens in different ways. See, for us, we're not used to earthquakes. It's not something that we get a lot here in the Midwest. But in this moment, it was the manifestation of God's judgment, the voice of God's glory, His presence, as we saw Jesus' glory. It's that same glory that's on Him. It comes from God. And so as we experience this, I mean, I'll be honest, the only earthquake I've ever been through, I slept through. And so while the earth trembles and the earth shakes and it quakes, it can cause us to tremble. But yet it's different when it's the judgment of God. So therefore, it's not just that the earth shook, but rather it was shaking our biggest enemies, sin and death. By this time, when the earth shook, it was caused by the arrival of the angel, as it says that he came and he opened up the tomb, that he rolled back the stone, and there he finds himself seated above. But what we see here is this: the angel did not come to move the stone to let the Lord out. The angel had moved the stone to let the women in so they could see what was already done. And so this terrifies the Roman soldiers. This is they passed out, they were gone. And if we're being completely honest, it would have been the same way for us. These women were terrified. They were shaken. They didn't know what to think. What's going on? So their arrival at the tomb, as they find themselves there, they came to perform this task. But now everything's changed. It's funny how so many of these sermons, week after week, we've talked about that they've come to Jesus expecting one thing, and yet it was not what they received. He changes the lives amongst us. They arrive at the tomb where they expected to see him, but he was no longer there. The empty tomb is not a current place, but a former place that displays the power of the one who removed himself. All that was left were his wrappings and his garments that connected to this path, to his death. The rags of the body were covered in, that were prepared for burial, they were all left behind. The sight of the empty tomb might have been more than terrifying than the earthquake itself. The perspective that John gives us of the tomb is slightly different. As Mary was terrified, she missed the angel. She missed the fact that Jesus removed himself. She was filled with trembling because she missed what was going on. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." She missed it. I mean, she literally missed it. The angel, the stone, Jesus is gone. Everything has changed. Something missed. It's crazy how we can go to those places so quickly. How strong denial can be, and how disbelief can blind us from what we're physically enduring. Her fear drove her to flee, to run, to find someone else, while the other women were afraid, but something kept them there. It was the witness to what God had done. The angel answered their questions. Even in the midst of their shock, they were receiving answers. Now that's a prayer that we all can get behind. Lord, just tell me why, tell me what, tell me how. That's a question we ask all the time. Verse 5 says, "The angel said to the women, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who is crucified. He is not here, he is risen. Just as he said, come and see the place where he lay.'" While Matthew, it seems so simple, like the angel is telling them this was going to solve it all. But Luke and Mark said that the women had to be told twice. That when they got inside the tomb, the story was repeated to them once again. So while they heard the message, it doesn't mean that it necessarily comprehended it. They're still in shock. And maybe their shock was different than the first Mary's shock, because their shock caused them to stand still. They froze. And so for them, their fear was relevant. Their fear was what happened to them. Their fear was in disbelief. I can't believe this is happening right now to me. But don't forget, there's someone else that's there as well. The soldiers. I mean, we get a clear response of what the women were going through. But what about the soldiers? You know, the ones who were there to place the guard the tomb so that nobody would come and disturb the body, so that way the prophecy wouldn't be fulfilled by man. That no one would come and take the body just so they could say he did it. He said he would be out. They were there to guard so no one would disturb, so no one could make this prophecy true. So it might be hard to believe, but they were startled too. I mean, They've seen war. They've seen all this that takes place, but what was the fear of the angel that was upon him? And Jesus is gone, and now it's the uh-oh, we're in trouble. These men had seen battle. They've been tested, and yet here they're shaking with fear. It has to be a combination of what they've witnessed through the angel's presence, but also knowing we've let go, that this was our one job, and he's not here. Even more so, what they began to realize is we're not in control of the situation. This is bigger than us. See, the women were afraid by the hearing of the angel's testimony as they were mourning the loss of Jesus. But through the testimony of the angels, the fear of their loss was restored by hope. The soldiers were afraid because what they were originally put their trust in was now gone and was now without hope. It's interesting that both of these characters, the women and the soldiers, both had similar responses to this very moment. They both were filled with fear and disbelief, but they had two different results. The women were now filled with hope, as the men were now filled with devastation. So what does this mean? That's what this whole thing is about. What does this mean for us? Because up to this story, we can paint the picture. We can try to assemble the facts. We can research. We can study. But rather, what is about to take place is the transforming joy that happens with us. Verse 7 says, "Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead, and he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you," so that the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell the disciples. You see that they were afraid, but yet were full of joy. It's like, we're unsure, but yet we're excited. We have no proof, but yet at the same time, we've heard this, and so now it's a ball of emotion. I don't know what to think. I'm sad. I'm crying. I'm joyful. I'm happy. But yet here, up to this point in the story, we put our own picture together. See, what they just experienced was life-changing. It was life-altering. It was going to be a huge difference. It was the truth of the resurrection. It wasn't just prophecy. It wasn't just a promise. It wasn't just a foretelling, but it happened. It actually happened. It is now truth. It is now real. It is now present in their lives. And they were full of joy. So what does it mean to live with Christ? It's when we are obedient to Christ. It's when it's revealed to us. In verse 9, it says, "Suddenly Jesus met them. Greetings," he said. They came to him. They clasped his feet and they worshiped him. And then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brother to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." See, their joy was not in their ability to understand. Can we get an amen to that? Can we get an amen that we don't have to have it all understood? It doesn't have to be all put together. The picture doesn't have to be pieced together perfectly. But rather, it was trusting in the one who was leading them. The resurrection was God who was going to put a stamp of approval, that he was going to say this was real, that this was right, this is true. It was revealing to us that Jesus was more than just good deeds. He didn't just do it because it was what he was supposed to do, but rather it was a revelation of his greatness. It was his authority, and it was the goodness of God. And John tells us, he says, "If you know me, then you know my Father." To know Jesus is more than just a glimmer of hope that makes our lives better. It's not just a feel-good feeling, but it reveals to us the greatness, the authority, and the goodness of God who came to save us. And so in this moment, that they went from complete fear, question, devastation, to celebration with the joy and the reality of Jesus being alive. This resurrection wasn't temporary, therefore they could go in joy because they know whom which they believe in is able to keep them. Today we celebrate that same joy, that it never ends. And so we don't have to fear the truth of the resurrection. It's because we have this reality. When we fear, it's because we don't believe. If we don't believe, we don't have the joy of the resurrection because we don't know him. The idea of the cross can seem scary. The history of the resurrection might be overwhelming. But together, they bring the future. Only together do they bring the future of eternity. So then, we find ourselves in this place. Let us not fear to worship. Let us not fear to trust. Let our fears go, because we know him, and we know his power, and we've experienced him, and we have to choose to receive him. What his death brought to all who will choose him. It's our time. It's our time to make a choice. It's to make a decision. And for some, it's going to look different. For some, it's to say, you know what? It's time that I give my life to Christ. It's time that I need to give myself to him. That I need to be baptized. I need to make a declaration that I want to be his. Some of you might be young and you say, well, that's the natural time. Some of you might be older and you're like, well, it's too late. Maybe, you know, you never missed it. Doesn't matter how old you are, you didn't miss it. The opportunity is still yours. It's still to be had today and now. As Colossians 3 says, since then, you have been raised with Christ and set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Jesus came, he died, he rose. And Jesus will come again. When we encounter the resurrected one, it will either leave you in total despair or it will bring total change to you. We'll be able to face anything when you realize that the suffering of death has lost its power. The things that we experience in this life are only momentary things. They're given away to an eternity with the Father. Will you choose today? Will today be your point, your starting point, your declaration says that I want to live with Christ? And whether it's a choice to choose to be baptized, a declaration that says I want to give my life, or maybe just saying, you know what, I've got to improve on things and today's the day that I'm going to change those things. We focus so much on January 1, a happy new year, a resolution. But for Christians, today should be our day one. Today should be the day that we set a new mark, a new precedent for the way that we live and the way that we seek to follow after Christ. Will you choose today to follow after him? Yes, I will lift you high.